It's been a busy and rough start to 2023 for many New Zealanders. And I'd say our politicians will agree, flooding, cyclones and the threat of another measles outbreak on the horizon. To discuss all this and more, we welcome our first minor party political panel of 2023, Greens MP Chlöe Swarbrick and ACT Deputy Leader Brooke van Velden. Morena, kia kōrua. Thank you both for being here this morning. Brooke, let's just start with the fact that you were once upon a time a Greens voter and now you're an ex-supporter, I should say. How did that happen?
Oh, well, it's quite simple. You know, I care about climate change, I care about the environment, but the more I looked into policies, I realised the policies that the Greens Party espouse don't actually go any way to helping with the environment, but they actually harm the economy at the same time. So I found a party that aligned with environmentalism and helping people strive for better and for a better economy.
Chlöe, I know you're not going to sit there and...
No. Throughout my time at uni, just to declare it off the bat, I once flirted with the idea of libertarianism, which is ostensibly the ideology underpinning the ACT Party, that is, you know, everybody's allowed to do what they want with the harm principle, that is, do no harm to others. But as you kind of get further down the track and unpack that ideology and start to understand how it is that we come to form society, you can come to understand that talking about freedom is a pretty hollow notion when not everybody has access to the material wealth or otherwise that they need to participate in utilising those freedoms. So again, that's why the Greens have that solid philosophical underpinning of kind of serving both people and the planet, because as we're seeing with the flooding and with the cyclones and otherwise, you know, we have an economy that is fundamentally unsustainable and continues to be extractive, continues to produce excessive waste, and we need that transformation.
It's a good segue, actually, because we do want to talk about what has been happening over the last couple of weeks. And I just wonder from both of you whether the government is actually doing enough for our communities, particularly on the East Coast. We know that the government's just announced $25 million. That's to go towards trying to rebuild some of those businesses, the initial impacts, trying to get them back on their feet. But Brooke, is the government doing enough for our communities? And we can talk about what they're doing now, we can talk about whether the infrastructure, you know, what needs to be done there, but I just want your initial thoughts.
Yeah, look, I think a lot of people will be wanting support and needing support. They've gone through a lot of struggle and people have lost nearly everything that they have. I think civil defence payments are a very good short-term measure. What I think we need to look at long-term is how we get infrastructure and how we mitigate against climate change problems. Because I don't think we've had a good enough debate about that. You know, when I look at infrastructure and even what's happened up here in the floods, we've had people who've been flooded because their drains haven't been cleared. We need better upgrades and for our infrastructure and maintenance of it. But when I look ahead, I don't want to see us having a conversation about, well, everything's to do with climate change and it means that we have to mitigate and cut farmers' number of cows and we have to subsidise Tesla owners against ute owners. I think we need to look at how do we actually adapt to climate change, and that's through more money being spent on good infrastructure. And my members' bill, which will be debated this year, is about giving councils money to help them fund the vital infrastructure that's needed in our communities.
I want to come back to Three Waters because I know that that's all part of it as well. Chlöe, in terms of what has been happening, you've been talking to people within Auckland who have been impacted because we've been talking and focusing on the East Coast, but there's still issues here in Tamaki Makaurau as well.
Yeah, I guess, you know, to take this all back to kind of first principles, this isn't a recovery and rebuilding moment. This is a kind of don't look up moment, if I'm honest with you. This is what we mean when we're talking about the climate emergency. What we've all experienced, sure, is unprecedented in terms of our human, direct, individual experiences of climate change. But it's been predicted in the modelling that if we continue to put these fossil fuels, these climate-changing emissions into our atmosphere, these are precisely the kinds of extreme weather events that we can continue to expect will increase in their extremity. So I agree with at least the high-level rhetoric that we're hearing from Brooke there with regard to the need to adapt, But genuine climate adaptation, that is building our cities properly, like sponge cities, so that they can absorb these deluges, is actually also meaningful climate mitigation. So the fastest growing emissions profile in Aotearoa, New Zealand, is transport. And in Tamaki Makaurau, the biggest emissions profile is transport. Yet we continue to be so focused from a political and policy level on fostering car dependency, on not enabling people the freedom of, for example, rapid transit networks, of walking and cycling, all of those things which are both climate adaptation and mitigation and actually far more cost effective.
But would you agree that this isn't going to happen anytime soon? This is going to take lots of money. This is going to take time in order for everything that you're talking about to be implemented. But in the meantime, What do our communities need? What do they need us to be doing for them? What do they need the government
Absolutely.
Doing?
So, I mean, the Greens have called for a doubling of that civil defence payment because I think it's really important also for us to drill into the fact, you know, if you go down to Māngere CDC and down south and you talk to people there, what you find is that when a disaster like this strikes, a climate-fueled disaster like this strikes, inequality compounds. It is really expensive to be poor, and if you can't afford insurance in the first place, then you are in an impossible situation when you lose absolutely everything.
Brooke, I want to bring you in here.
Well, I think, firstly, I want to say to all the community members who have been out there helping each other that they're doing the bulk of the work. You know, I was down in Hawke's Bay just last week. I went to one of the worst affected streets in Havelock North and talked to the volunteers, and they said 200 volunteers from the local community had come out that weekend to put their own gloves on and help people. And I think that's really wonderful. Where the government does need to step in, of course, could be where you've had orchardists who have lost nearly everything. But of course, we have to be very sensible with that approach. It can't be blanket. There's a lot of orchards that also haven't been affected. So there needs to be a policy there about looking at what the actual harm for each individual was and how that will affect their business rather than a blanket help package.
If I can, you know, I've spent 5 years trying to figure out how to calmly and rationally talk about this climate emergency. And over the past few weeks, I have been out there with people ripping up carpets and curtains and speaking to folks who have lost absolutely everything. We need radical transformation because actually transformation is inevitable. Whether it happens to us by virtue of the rapidly changing climates that is being driven to these extremes by virtue of human activity, or we make that economic transformation to ensure that everybody has what they need to survive and that we are resilient to the changing weather.
Look, I do think we need to be more resilient to the changing weather. And that's why, you know, we actually want intensification of cities, but what we didn't agree to was National and Labor last year saying that they wanted three-story homes on every property without adding infrastructure. You know, we're losing permeability of our surfaces. We don't have the stormwater infrastructure to support it. And we're expecting that local councils will just allow everybody to build whatever they want on whatever property they want within our big cities. I think we need smarter responses when it comes to what infrastructure we need and about how we mitigate against climate change. You know, we already have an emissions trading scheme. What the Greens Party are putting out there are policies that say we're not actually going to reduce emissions within an industry, we're going to pick and choose winners. I want to see us have a smarter debate about how we go forward with climate change, and that's about infrastructure. Because if you look at the reality of the situation, even if we reduce our emissions, and that could be a very good goal in New Zealand, there's still billions of people around the world that will emit because they want to feed their families, and we're going to have to adapt.
It's a classic ACT Party line, honestly. If you add up every country in this world that emits less than 1%, you are talking about a quarter of the countries on this planet. We can't point our finger at even those big emitters and say that they have to get their act in line if we're not willing to do it ourselves.
Unfortunately, we do have to wrap things up because we've gone way over, but I knew that this would happen given the debate in what we're living through currently. So we so appreciate both of you being here with us this morning, Brooke and Chlöe. Tēnā kōrua.